Yeah, perfect, perfect. Go ahead. You are fine to go.
First of all, I want to thank all the faculty for giving me this opportunity. Myself, Dr. Divya Kumari, junior resident second year from the Department of General Surgery, Institute of Medical Sciences, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi, under the moderation of Professor Ajay Khanna sir. My HOD is Professor Puneet sir, and my thesis guide is Professor Seema Khanna ma'am. Today, I'm going to present the case of thyroid swelling. A 32-year-old lady, resident of Balia, UP, presented to surgery OPD with chief complaints of swelling in front of neck for 2 years. Patient was apparently asymptomatic 2 years back when her family member noticed a swelling in front of neck. It was insidious in onset, initially small in size, around 2 into 2 centimeters, and it gradually progressed to attain the present size of 5 into 5 centimeters. There was no history of rapid or sudden increase in size of the swelling or pain over the swelling. There were no pressure symptoms like difficulty in swallowing or difficulty in breathing or change of voice. There was no complaint of other swellings in neck. There was no history suggestive of hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism, no history suggestive of metastasis. In past history, there was no other known comorbidities, no history of irradiation to head and neck. There was no history of surgery in the past. In family history, no family history suggestive of any thyroid swelling or any cancer in the family. In treatment history, no history of any drug intake or for any thyroid disorder. In personal history, patient is on mixed diet with normal sleeping pattern, history of consuming brassica family vegetables, no bowel or bladder habit abnormalities, no history of smoking, tobacco or alcohol addiction. Patient has regular menstrual cycle with 5 days of normal flow and 28 to 30 days interval. Coming to summary of my history, 32-year lady with gradually progressive swelling in thyroid region for 2 years without any pressure symptoms, with no history suggestive of hypo or hyperthyroidism, without any significant family history.
And you go to the first slide from the history.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Swelling in the front of the neck for 2 years. That is complaint is okay.
Yeah.
Go to the next slide. See, the usually it may be insidious and usually small in size. That is okay. You cannot make it as around 2 centimeter. You cannot make it as 2 cross 2 centimeter. No, usually we don't on inspection or palpation. You can see in history of presenting illness, better not to mention as 2 cross 2 into 5 cross 5 like that. No, you can
yes,
approximately
sir.
Say size of around 2 centimeter, which has yes. progressed to that present size. Okay.
Yes.
Go to the next slide. Okay, there is no history of sudden increase in size of the swelling or pain over the swelling. If there is pain in the swelling, what and all is your interpretation? If the patient complains of pain also.
Ma'am, in case of thyroid swelling, pain usually if there is a hemorrhage inside the nodule, inside the swelling, then patient can present with the pain. Or in case of some thyroiditis, like acute thyroiditis, in that case, patient can present with the pain. Or if benign swelling going towards the malignancy, then patient can present with the pain.
Okay. Which malignancy usually presents as a dull aching pain in the thyroid?
Medullary carcinoma.
Yeah, good. Medullary thyroid carcinoma may present as a dull aching. Otherwise, it is a late feature of a thyroid malignancy.
See, I don't know it is whether because of the time constraint or it is a routine practice. We don't expect you to give your interpretation in history. There is no signs of hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism. You must mention few. That is the interpretation. That is not the finding. So as far as our concerns, it is that you must mention the actual facts, and then later you can interpret it. Okay.
Yes.
You said there is no pressure symptom. No pressure symptom. It is the interpretation. You must mention the facts. There is no, you know, difficulty in swallowing. All that.
Yes.
And again, what we teach that the component of the history taking is that we have to take history of the onset, duration, progress to come to some logical differential diagnosis. Based upon the diagnosis, in history of present illness, you must ask history of complications and history of etiology. So the history of dietary history in a thyroid patients comes in the history of etiology in the history of present illness, not in the personal illness. Okay. You must mention it in the history of present illness, history of radiation, history of dietary history, history of any other medications. So that you must mention the history of present illness, whether in goitrogenic drugs she's taking or in all that.
Yes.
What are other faculty's opinion about this?
Yeah, we should, I think she should have mentioned about the hypo or hyperthyroidism features, at least in a small way. Yeah. Otherwise, it is not correct. She cannot tell it is euthyroid. Okay. And also how it started, which side it started and how it progressed, whether it is, you said in front of the neck, whether it is on the right side, left side, where it started, how it progressed, we don't know. So everything should be in depth, in detail, in the history itself.
Yes.
Okay, proceed.
Coming to general physical examination, patient was examined in a well-lit room with informed consent in a sitting position. Patient was cooperative and well-oriented to time, place, and person. Patient is nutritionally well-preserved with BMI of 22.3 kilogram per meter square. With vitals, patient was afebrile at the time of examination with pulse rate 84 per minute, regular in rhythm. Blood pressure was 118/76 in left arm, supine position. Respiratory rate was 18 cycles per minute. Pallor, ichthyosinusitis, clubbing, pedal edema, and generalized lymphadenopathy was absent. This is the clinical picture of the patient.
1 minute, doctor. Regarding the pulse, I think you should mention clearly about pulse in the case of a thyroid. Or go to the general examination?
Yes.
You have just told about the pulse rate and regular in rhythm. Anything else you have to add in the pulse? Because pulse talks more in the case of a thyroid. What else you should have added?
I'm like with good volume, and then there is no radial delay, no radiofemoral delay.
Not only what is any arrhythmias are there, everything you should mention, no, whether it is normal. Volume also is important. Okay. Pulse should be told in depth. Okay. Go to that.
Okay. Any eye signs is there?
No, sir. I have mentioned in the other system, sir, the later slide. This is the clinical picture of the patient.
Okay, proceed.
In the examination of neck in inspection, I examined the patient in sitting position with me in front at the same level with a female attendant. A globular swelling of size 6 x 5 cm seen in thyroid region. It was confined to the right side. Lower border of swelling was visible. Swelling was moving with deglutition. Skin over the swelling was normal. No dilated veins noted over the neck and the upper chest. And there was no other swelling noted in the neck. Coming to palpation. Palpation was done from behind with neck slightly flexed. There was no local rise of temperature. Swelling was non-tender. A swelling of size of around 6 x 5 cm present in right side of neck with a smooth surface, well-defined border with palpable lower border. Swelling was firm in consistency. Extent of swelling from midline to behind medial border of right sternocleidomastoid, above up to thyroid cartilage and below up to right sternoclavicular joint. Swelling is mobile in both directions with trachea and not fixed to underlying structures or overlying skin. There was no pulsation or thrill palpable. Rest of the thyroid gland was not palpable. Trachea was in midline. Bilateral carotid artery palpable at their normal position. No other swelling palpable in the neck. No cervical lymph nodes were palpable. In auscultation, no bruit heard. Coming to other systems, ear, nose, throat, scalp and spine examination were normal. In eye sensor, eye examination was within normal limit. No tremor or fasciculation in tongue seen. Proximal myopathy was absent. In CNS, higher mental function normal with normal cranial, sensory, motor examination with normal reflexes. In CV, cardiovascular system, normal S1 and S2 heard, no murmur heard. Respiratory system, bilateral normal vesicular breath sounds heard, no added sound. In upper abdomen was soft, non-tender, no organomegaly palpable. Coming to summary, 32-year lady with gradually progressive swelling in thyroid region for 2 years without any pressure symptoms. or associated pain with no history suggestive of hypo or hyperthyroidism without any significant family history, a single firm globular swelling of size 6 into 5 cm in thyroid region in the right side moving with deglutition, rest of thyroid gland non-palpable without cervical lymphadenopathy with no evidence of retroesternal prolongation. My provisional diagnosis is non-toxic solitary thyroid nodule, probably benign.
I think you have to go to the inspection. Go to the first line, inspection. Yeah, lobular swelling. Lower border of the swelling is visible. Moving with deglutition alone is enough, or you should mention anything else also along with that? An inspection.
Swelling moving upwards with the protrusion of tongue.
It should also, because it is a single swelling in the region of the thing, we should also look for movement with protrusion of the tongue also. And should you mention the position of the trachea in inspection itself?
Seeing the sternocleidomastoid, like we can say whether the trachea is central in position or not in the inspection.
I think you should mention that also in the inspection. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So will you check a plumbariton test here in this case? Do not mention.
Sir, on inspection and palpation, there was lower border was palpable, so I have not mentioned about the plumbariton.
So you did not to mention about the palpatory finding. Even on inspection, if the lower border can be seen, then you need to go for the plumbariton test.
Okay.
Inspectory test, plumbariton test.
Yes.
I will do plumbariton's test.
Sir, in plumbariton's test, I will ask the patient to raise both the hand above the level so that it will touch the ear, and I will ask the patient to keep their hand in that disposition for 3 minutes. If there is retroesternal prolongation of the thyroid, patient will have congestion of face and the respiratory distress patient will develop, then it is plumbariton sign positive.
One more important thing you are missing. You have to ask him to raise the hand, and so you ask him to take deep breath. Okay. So by taking the so what is the purpose of raising the hand? What we achieve?
The thoracic inlet will narrow down.
The thoracic. So you must look for the congestion of the vessels on the face plus prominence of the neck veins. Both you have to see. Prominence of the neck vein and facial congestion. Okay. Good.
Dr. Divya,
yes.
Two things. When you were mentioned 6x5, tell us vertically what is the dimension and horizontally what is always learn. Why?
Yes,
why is that important? Suppose I tell you there is a swelling in the, say, hyoid bone area, hyoid bone. Horizontally, 4 cm and vertically 3 cm. Horizontally 4 cm and vertically 3. What is your diagnosis? I'm just giving a thought to you so that you open up your mind. Midline swellings. Okay, to say it is a subhyoid bursitis are usually transversely oval. Transversely oval. Suppose you say vertically 4 cm and horizontally 3, it becomes a thyroglossal cyst. Is it clear?
Yes.
So whenever I understand 6 is vertical and 5 is horizontal, but you need to tell, number one.
Yes.
Second is also mention and make a policy to give a glass of water whenever you say movement with the deglutition. There's no point in go on, ask the patient to swallow, hardly any saliva there. So you should make a policy to give a glass of water. Okay.
Yes.
Please,
yes. Dr. Devya, why do you say it is a benign swelling? Why it could not be malignant?
Sir, it could be a malignant case, but there were no symptoms and signs like suggestive of malignancy. So I have kept benign etiology most probably.
What are those points you want to say?
First of all, sir, patient suspects like female in female carcinoma is more less likely suspected, sir. And then the age group is like 32 age of the patient. Then sir, there are no risk factors, like there is no history of radiation to head and neck. That is the one thing, sir. And then in the palpation, then in the sir examination finding, sir, swelling is a single solitary nodule, sir, which is firm in consistency, and border is sir like well defined. So
Yeah, you are right. Those are the points regarding the radiation exposure. You took the history. Yeah?
Yes, sir. Yes.
What is the duration of the radiation exposure after which the patients usually develop malignancy? And at what dose the patients develop radiation exposed malignancy?
Usually, sir, in the childhood age, like if the patient has exposure to radiation, then after 5 to 6 years, patient can develop, the patient have the risk factor to develop the thyroid malignancy, sir. But it can develop, like it can take 20 to 30 years of a time interval to develop the...
Usually take 20 to 40 years. What is at what dose it? What is the lower dose? What is the upper dose?
Well, sir, up to 200 centigrade, like the usual.
Now, usually we give dose, for which diseases this dose is given?
Lymphomas.
Lymphomas, we give a higher dose. This is usually for the high. Adenoid hyperplasia, thymus hyperplasia, and the lowest dose is even of 6.5 centigrade for the tinea capitis. It can also cause. If you give more than 2,000, that is usually given for Hodgkin's lymphoma. Why there is no incidence of, after 2,000, if the exposure is more, there is no incidence of thyroid carcinoma. Why?
Because basically, sir, it will ablate all the thyroid glands, so there are no thyroid tissue left.
Yeah, more than this, again, there is no chance of malignancy because whole of the thyroid gland is itself ablated. Right.
Divya, when this question was asked to you, why not malignancy, you should start from a history-wise, there is no hoarseness to the voice. Very vital point.
Yes.
You should
yes.
not forget that.
Yes.
No hoarseness to the voice. No rapid growth that you have mentioned. Most of the other things you have mentioned. And somewhere you mentioned about the mobility. What is that mobility you checked here?
The vertical and the horizontal mobility, and it was mobile along with the trachea. So there was no independent mobility of the swelling itself.
Not that important in the thyroid for the reason. It is enclosed by the pretracheal fissure, and you know it cannot have that independent kind of a thing. But if you have got a very small nodule, which is not at all mobile, not at all mobile, hard and fixed, what do you suspect? A nodule which is hard and fixed, can't even move. So suspect malignancy, right? Fix it into what? Fix it into what? That's what I want to know from you. If it is fixed to trachea, you can move with the trachea. If it is
fixed to maybe the prevertebral fascia, then
yes, behind. In that type of situations, it's typical that anaplastic carcinoma and all, no, they behave like that. So you need to know that. So that is what is important. And rest of the gland is not palpable. What test you did to detect that? That question will be asked.
Yes, sir. Sir, as the swelling is present on the right side of the lobe, sir, for to palpate the left side of the lobe by the Lahis method, I have palpated the left side of the lobe, sir, and that gland was that lobe was not palpable, sir.
Did you mention? Yes, sorry,
yes.
You said about no other swelling palpable in the neck. Means what?
Yes.
What do you mean by that?
For cervical lymph nodes only.
That is next line.
Yes.
Next line, is there no cervical lymph nodes?
Yes.
Which are the nodes which normally you expect rather to examine in thyroid swellings?
Lateral group of lymph nodes. Because central group of lymph nodes usually they won't be palpable. So lateral group of lymph nodes like can be palpable. Sir.
So you mean
in
to
case
say
of malignancy?
2, 3, 4, 5.
That's what
we are trying to say here, correct?
Yes.
So that is what we should say. Jugular lymphatic chain, basically jugular lymphadenopathy. So that no other swelling is palpable is not really required in this patient. Okay, other,
yes.
You already mentioned rest of the thyroid gland is not palpable.
Yes.
Right.
Suggest you mentioned that Lyse method. What are the indication of Lyse method? When will you palpate gland with Lyse method? How to do Lyse palpation with Lyse?
Sir, in case of if we want to palpate the posterior portion of the lobe, then with the Lyse method we can palpate the one lobe. In that, sir, like if we want to palpate the left lobe of the thyroid gland, we have to push the right lobe towards the left side, so that left lobe become more prominent and the posterior part comes to the lateral. And so then with the
what will happen if you push the right lobe? And the left lobe, where it will go then? It will again go behind the sternocleidomastoid.
Okay.
If you push it laterally, again, yes, left lobe will go behind the sternocleidomastoid. Okay.
Yes.
So as you rightly mentioned, this should be done when we want to palpate the posterior or lateral most border of the thyroid gland.
Right.
So what is the important thing is that if the inspection or rest of the palpation from the behind, if the lateral border cannot be appreciated because it has gone behind the sternocleidomastoid, and still if you want to palpate it, then you must palpate with the Lyse method.
Yes.
That's, you must come in front of the patient, and before pushing your right lobe, you must keep your hand, this ulnar surface, anterior to the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid, and then you push the right lobe so that the left lobe will slide over your this palpating hand.
Okay.
Then you can palpate it by manually.
Yes.
Are you getting?
Yes.
So first, yes, before pushing the gland, you must keep your hand in front of the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid, and then push the gland so the gland will glide over your this palpating.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And this Kreil's method, when will you palpate? When you do palpation with Kreil's method?
Kreil's method is used for, sir, if we want to palpate any small nodule, if we are suspecting in the lobe, then with the pulp of the thumb, like we can feel for the small nodules in the gland.
That's not enough again.
Then with the front of the patient, in the front of the patient, if we want to palpate any small nodules, then with the pulp of the finger, we will ask the patient to swallow, and then during that time, like we can feel for the nodule.
So you have to keep your finger on the anterior surface of the gland and ask patient to swallow. And when patient is swallowing, when the gland is moving with the deglutition, that time you have to feel with the steady hand whether there are any nodularity on the anterior surface of the gland. Okay. Next.
What is the relation of thyroid to the sternocleidomastoid?
Thyroid is behind and medial to the sternocleidomastoid.
Can it ever come in front of the sternocleidomastoid? Big swelling?
No, sir.
Yeah, it will never come, you know?
Yes.
So you can blindly say that this swelling which is there is deep to the sternocleidomastoid.
Yeah.
Which carotid pulsation did you feel?
The common carotid.
What other carotids you can feel in the neck?
Sir, in the neck, external carotid can be felt, sir, at the level of the, like near the mastoid, we can feel for the external carotid pulsation, sir.
And where can you feel the internals?
Internals, sir, can't be feel in the neck, sir.
Mm-hmm. So if you have to feel the internal, where you will feel that?
In the oral cavity, sir, along the tonsillar pillar or the tonsillar fossa, we can palpate for the internal carotid.
Okay, what are the various ways to see for the exophthalmos?
One is the Napziger test, sir. With that, like you can see the exophthalmos, sir.
Right. So one is the Napziger, yes.
Yes. Other side only.
No, from the front, you can't see that from the front. That is the first thing you see to say the patient has exophthalmos. No, you can see the limbus all around.
Yes.
OK. Okay, so you see the sclera which is there all around the cornea, no? So that is, and then you can see it from the side also, that whether that is protruding or not, or you can go on the top of the patient and see whether it is fronting, it is coming in front of the supraorbital arch or not. So from the various ways you can look for the exophthalmos.
How to check for von Grafe's sign?
The von Grafe's sign is like lid lag, sir. In that, like with the one hand, with the left hand, we can steady the patient's head, and then one finger, like we will keep the index finger in front of the patient's eye level, and then we will ask the patient to follow the finger, and slowly we will move the finger downwards, sir. In that, we can see the lid lag. The upper eyelid will lag behind the eyeball.
No, you should not do it slowly.
Yes.
You should not. See, you must ask patient, you must fix his head. At what distance you will keep your finger from the patient?
Sorry, sir?
What distance? How far?
Sir, around like 1 meter distance.
1 meter approximately. It should not be too close. It should not. It should be up beyond the point of focal length of the patient. At 1 meter, you must keep. And first, you must check the eye movements in all direction. If patient is having extraocular environment, then you are not able to elicit von Grafe's sign. So when the eye movements are normal, you must check. That time, you must move your finger slowly in all directions. And again, bring your finger to in front of the eyes, and you rapidly move it down. So patient, give instruction to the patient. You follow my finger. So when it is rapidly, the eyeball will move, but the lids will not move down. If it is slow, the lid may follow your eyeball. But if it is rapid, then there will be lid lag. Okay. So how to check Mobius sign?
Mobius sign, sir. Again, sir, we will fix the patient's head, and then we will keep the one. We will keep our index finger, sir, far near the patient, and then slowly we will bring it towards the patient's side, sir, and we will ask the patient to follow the finger, sir.
So what is the end point?
End point will be, sir, near the around 1 meter distance, patient.
When you will stop bringing finger close to the patient? What, how will you interpret the test?
There will be no convergence of the eyeball, sir.
So how you will come to know?
There will be no like eyeball movement towards the medial. There will be no adduction of the eyeball, sir.
No.
And patient will not follow the
when patient will start seeing two fingers instead of one finger. When we start seeing two fingers, so that's the point where you are going beyond the focal point. So you have to measure that focal point. If it is, what is normal focal length?
25 centimeter.
If it is beyond that, then you can say the this Mobius sign is positive and patient having extraocular. So what does it indicate, Mobius sign?
Extraocular muscle involvement, sir.
Right. Next.
Dr. Devya, why do you get eye signs in hyperthyroidism or toxicosis? Why do we get these eye signs? What is the pathology? Why all these eye muscles and these are affected?
Sir, because of the overactivity of the sympathetic system, sir, and because of the deposition of the glucosaminoglycan, sir, in the retrobulbar space.
Yeah, why do it deposit there?
Because of the cross reactivity of the antigens, sir.
Not cross reactivity. You are right, but it's not cross reactive. The orbital fibroblast antigenic and muscles have a same antigen as the TSHR. Okay, so all those antibodies which are acting against the TSHR, thyroid stimulating hormone receptor antigen, they also act there and induce inflammation there. So cytokines are initiated, there is inflammation, this leads to deposition of glycoma and glycosides and dermopathy there in that region, leading to these various eye signs affecting the muscles of the eyeball. Right?
Yes.
In how many percentage of, like, Graves is the most common cause of hyperthyroidism? How many percentage of patients you get these signs?
Around 30 to 50%, sir.
Yeah, 50% of the patients in the later stage. And how many patients are affected with a dermopathy?
15 to 30%.
No, only 1 to 2%. Right?
Yes.
Okay, so how you will investigate this patient?
Sir, first I will go for the thyroid function test to see the patient's thyroid status.
Okay. What picture you are supposed to get in this case?
Sir, by the history and also, like, my patient is euthyroid, so mostly, sir, normal TSH level with the normal T3 and T4 level.
Before investigation, just 1 minute, sir. Did you mention bony swellings? Did you check for any? Did you mention that?
There is spine examination, like.
No. Spine is least important in thyroid. Spine is not important.
Another question, why do you want to examine a spine? What spine do you expect in this case?
Always remember, breast normally goes for a thoracic, lumbar, and all that spine. And which carcinoma thyroid produces bone metastasis?
Follicular.
So which bones?
Long bones. Long bones on the skull.
Flat bones. Not long bones. So you need to please mention there, bony swellings means scalp, ribs, sternum, all that thing. More common.
Yeah.
Any idea why is that? Why flat bones? Some affinity. That's because they're supposed to maintain the red marrow for a little longer time. And breast, why spine is more commonly involved? Any idea?
Spine plexus, sir.
Through the posterior intercostal vein, the spread can occur along the paravertebral veins, Bat's plexus. Some of the reasons why it is mentioned. So, in the breast, it is more important to look for tenderness. Yeah. In thyroid, more important look for bony swelling. This is what you should understand. Okay?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Sir, please go ahead with investigation.
I will go for the thyroid function test, sir, to know the functional status of the thyroid, sir. In my case, sir, there are no signs in terms of the hypo or hyperthyroidism. So mostly TSH, T3 and T4 level will be within normal limits, sir.
Okay. So what is subclinical hyperthyroidism?
In case of subclinical hypothyroidism, TSH level will be, sorry, sir, subclinical hypothyroidism, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in subclinical hypothyroidism, sir, patient's T3 and T4 level will be normal, but TSH level will be slightly normal, sir. And it will be increased, sir.
Slightly increased. So what you will do to diagnose if there is biochemical deficiency, like which marker you would like to measure? Similarly, in hyperthyroidism also, in the early cases, you may get a normal T3, T4 and within normal range, some TSH.
Especially if the patient is having some pain.
Yeah.
What other investigation you'll add? Thyroid antibodies, I think.
Thyroid antibodies and free T3, T4 levels. Right? So they are the most early to rise or they fall. So they are more sensitive than the normal T3, bound T3, T4 levels. Okay.
Yeah.
So, okay, then what you will do next step, if your TSH is normal or slightly raised or T3, T4 are in the normal range, what is your next step?
Next, I will go for the ultrasound of the neck, sir. High resolution ultrasound of the neck.
What do you like to see?
First, I will
What is your aim, basically?
Sir, first I would like to see, as in my case, sir, it is a solitary thyroid nodule. So first I would like to confirm whether it is solitary or the multinodular, sir.
What is the significance of a multinodular and a solitary nodule? What you can confer or you can infer from this investigation ultrasound? In one patient, it is multinodular. One is clinically palpable. Other is not clinically palpable, detected on ultrasound. In another patient, it is only a single what you are palpating.
So the treatment can vary if the multinodular goiter, and if we are planning for any surgery, then
First we are regarding the diagnosis, na? Interpretation of this.
The multinodular goiter could be like it can be the chances of like multinodular goiter can be like follicular adenoma or follicular carcinoma. It can be, sir, and solitary thyroid nodule, it could be like the more chances of
malignancy. No chances of malignancy. Why? So do you think thyroid malignancy presents as multinodular?
Yes.
No, so if it is multinodular, it is less likely to be a malignant patient. Okay. If it is a solitary nodule, then it has a more probability as compared to the multinodular. So this is the first inference. What other things you will see in the ultrasound or ultrasound will detect?
Sir, we will. I want to see about the sir echogenicity of the nodule, sir.
Tell us the findings and interpretation. That is important. Anybody can say we will do the ultrasound. We should know what we want to see on the ultrasound.
Yes, sir. Sir, I would like to see the echogenicity of the nodule, sir.
So what you will infer if it is
cystic? In the echogenicity,
yeah.
Sir, in the echogenicity, if it is isoechoic or the hyperechoic, the chances of swelling will be more like benign, and if it is hypoechoic, then it will more infer towards the malignancy, sir.
Good. Next.
And what is the cystic?
Cystic will be more likely benign, sir.
More likely benign. Okay.
Then I would like to see about the borders, sir. If it is borders, like the margin, if it is well defined, sir, more likely it will be benign. And if it is the infiltrating border or the bursulated, then it will more suggest towards the malignancy, sir.
Malignancy or the pseudopod sign, which is said, there sometimes taking. Then what more you will see on the neck ultrasound?
Then, sir, I want to see about the vascularity of the nodule, sir. It is
Normal ultrasound will not tell you the vascularity, I think.
With the Doppler.
And do the you think we do you think Doppler is a routine investigation in neck? No. To see a nodule or a mass in the neck?
No. And I would like to see about sir, calcification in the nodule.
What type of calcification will get?
Fine calcification and speckled micro calcification, it will suggest towards the malignancy.
Okay, anything else?
I don't know. Is there any other teacher agree with her? Is micro calcification a sign of malignancy? I don't know. I'm not aware.
Divya, I think it is very important to tell what you are not uttering is the thyroids. Okay, nowadays the thyroid is always reported as just like we have the biroids for the breast.
Yeah.
The thyroids for that, no? And that includes all those whatever you are telling is included in that, no? And always you always do a duplex scan. It is never an ultrasound scan for the thyroid. You always combine it with the Doppler. Okay, so all the good machines, they have got the duplex. And all the good centers will be carrying out always a duplex scan because you have to definitely see for the vascularity, which is there inside there, or in the wall, which is there, how much the vascularity, that thing has to be seen. So if you just say one word, we will do the thyroid staging of that. That suffices for everything.
Yes.
What is other advantages of ultrasonogram?
Ma'am, we can see the lateral lymph nodes.
What is the percentage of solitary nodule turning into a multinodular goiter in a case of after ultrasonogram?
30%.
Yeah, more than 25%. Okay, it can be even up to 50%. Can change into impalpable. How? What ultrasonogram? What is the frequency we use for thyroid?
I'm usually 7.5 to 30 megahertz.
So it's high resolution. What is the advantage of using that high resolution? 10 to 12 megahertz, no? We use commonly. What is the advantage of using that?
I'm like up to 3 millimeter size of nodule, we can pick with this high resolution.
Impalpable nodules can be picked.
Can be picked.
So the size of the nodule also can be seen in ultrasonogram. That also matters for you to decide whether it is benign or malignant, whether it is your surgical modality, and also picking up of the, and taller than white. That is also a point you should add. Okay.
Yes.
About the ultrasound findings, whether you can differentiate a malignant lymph node from a benign lymph node?
Yes, ultrasound. Usually the normal shape of the lymph node is bean shaped, ma'am, kidney shaped. So in the if it will turn towards the malignancy, then ma'am, the shape of the lymph node will become oval. Then there will be loss of fatty hilum. And then cortical thickening will be there. Then internodular vascularity will increase in case of malignant lymph node.
Dr. Divya, can ultrasound differentiate a benign nodule from a malignant node apart from the other points? Is one specific thing you do? It is ultrasound elastography.
Yes.
Ultrasound elastography, yeah? That is recommended nowadays because it can differentiate, it can tell you the resistance or the deformity of a nodule.
Yes.
Because malignant nodules are more hard, though they may be having a same echogenicity. Yes. So with the same echogenicity, sometimes you can differentiate by the ultrasound elastography, whether it is benign or malignant. Now it is done along with the ultrasound in the same echogenicity nodules, right?
Yes.
So what other radiological investigation you would like to do?
X-ray, next, radiological.
Radiological X-ray to see what? To diagnose or for management purpose? It's more required by the anesthetist. Yeah, to see the tracheal deviation or compression on the trachea.
Yes.
And then any other investigation?
FNST.
Radiological.
CT. CT
yeah,
scan.
When it is indicated.
Sir, if we are suspecting if extrathyroidal extension of the disease,
large swellings, or if you are suspecting malignancy.
Malignancy, or in case of retrosternal
extension.
Yeah, extension. So then they are recommending. Otherwise, again, it is not usual investigation protocol for every thyroid swelling.
Yes.
Right? Okay.
Yes.
Then next investigation?
FNAC. I would like to go for FNAC.
Plain FNAC or anything else?
Ultrasound guided FNAC will be.
Yeah, better tell clearly as FNAC, yes. Ultrasound guided.
Ultrasound
Why you want to do ultrasound guided?
It will reduce the false negativity rate. It will give clear idea from where we can take the sample.
So if it is a cystic swelling or aspirating, if it is a cystic swelling and you're aspirating, there is no cells, what will you do then?
We can repeat, we can observe the swelling, ma'am. If it completely disappears and if it will not reaccumulate, then we can follow up the patient. If again it will reaccumulate, then maximum two times we can aspirate the cystic swelling, ma'am. And again, if it reaccumulates, then we can consider for the surgical treatment.
You can even aspirate from the cyst wall also if possible, one thing.
Okay.
And then if reaccumulates, you can do. If it is mixed echogenic, solid and cystic portion, what will you do then?
Then ma'am, FNAC sample should be taken from the solid component.
Yeah. So how will you interpret FNAC?
Ma'am, by the Bethesda grading, we can interpret in the class category ones, ma'am, it is unsatisfactory. So we should repeat FNAC in that case. Then in category two, it will be most likely benign. Benign etiology will be there. And class three will be RTPA of undetermined significant. And class four, follicular neoplasm. And then class 5 is ma'am suspicious for malignancy, and then class 6 is malignancy.
So what type of malignancy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Continue.
what type of malignancy you can get from FNAC itself.
Papillary can be diagnosed from the FNAC, and then medullary carcinoma can be diagnosed from the FNAC.
What is the role of scanning? Yeah, thyroid scanning.
Thyroid scanning is usually done in case of like if we are doing the TSH level and TSH is low, then in low. That case we can go for radioactive iodine scan.
Or technetium scan, yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, and what are another indication along with suppressed FSH?
In case of malignancy after thyroidectomy to see any residual disease.
No, before the diagnosis, before the management.
If TSH is low, sir, then only like.
And follicular nodule. If it is follicular nodular, then you can go for the iodine scanning, because if it is hot, it is unlikely to be malignant.
Malignant.
Yeah, if it is cold, then it has a 20% chance of malignancy. So that will differentiate them, then you will manage the case accordingly. So that is the indication in the pre-op period, or you sometimes do for thyrotoxicosis patients. Then there it is indicated to see whether it is a nodular thyrotoxicosis or it is a diffuse thyrotoxicosis, okay, like goiter or these things.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so what will be your management if you have follicular lesion of unknown significance or ATP of unknown significance on FNAC?
Sir, we can go for minimal surgery, minimal biopsy for in these cases, sir, hemithyroidectomy. So we can go for hemithyroidectomy.
Yeah, lobectomy, you can go for lobectomy and this. And if there is malignancy?
In case of malignancy, sir, like depending on the risk stratification, sir, whether it is a high-grade tumor or the low-grade, low risk, we can go for hemithyroidectomy or the total thyroidectomy. Sir.
Yeah. Usually, we go for total or near total thyroidectomy in these cases. Right. What is the, apart from malignancy, what are the other indications for near total or total thyroidectomy?
Sir, in case of large goiter, like multinodular goiter, we can go for total thyroidectomy in case of multinodular goiter. Then
why? The patient will become hypothyroid for the rest of the life. Why you want to go for total? You want to reduce the size. Why you are going for total thyroidectomy?
If in some multinodular goiter, if like it is involving both the lobe.
No, so why you are going for total?
So near total, we can go.
Near total you can go, but I am asking what is the another important indication for total thyroidectomy apart from malignancy?
In Graves' disease.
Yeah, good. When it is indicated in Graves' disease? It is not practiced in Indian subcontinent, but according to American societies, it should be done in specific indications. It is better than radioablation or putting the patient on antithyroid drugs.
If patient is having eye signs, in that case.
Yeah, very good. If there is ophthalmopathy, because only after surgery there is ablation, the reduction in the eye signs. Otherwise, radioablation also and your antithyroid drugs are not able to decrease the eye signs. Another indication?
If the thyroid gland is more suspicious.
No, if it is suspicious of malignancy, then it is a separate issue. I'm talking of there is no malignancy. Diagnosis is confirmed. And still you want to go for total thyroidectomy. It is done in Graves' disease, you are right. It is done in young patients. Because in young patients, if you treat only with the antithyroid drugs, within 6 to 8 weeks, you get control of the features, thyrotoxicosis. But as soon as you stop the drug, the symptoms reappear within 2 years in 80% of the patients. If you use radioactive iodine, then the patient is exposed to malignancy for the rest of his life.
Right.
So in young patients, they say go for total thyroidectomy.
Total thyroidectomy.
Why not subtotal thyroidectomy or near total?
recurrence of chances yeah, because, of recurrence of the disease will be there.
Because there is always a possibility of recurrence, and once there is a recurrence, then removing that tissue becomes very difficult. The injury chances to the recurrent laryngeal nerve or the superior laryngeal nerve significantly increases because the tissue is already scarred. So they say better go for total thyroidectomy and to put the patient on thyroxine. That is much better than in a young patient. If the patient is of old age, then radioablation is a good option because the incidence of malignancy appears after 20 to 30 years. So by that time, the patient is too old or he will be dying. But in a young patient, treating with radioablation, which is very good treatment though for the management. And putting the patients on antithyroid drug for the whole of the life, they don't tolerate sometimes. And they have the complication of these drugs like aplasia, granulocytopenia, even liver toxicities and all that. Yeah. So this is a very specific indication.
Dr. Divya, I think you should have in your investigations, the basic indirect laryngoscopy is a must. So you have not mentioned that. That should be done. Why?
To see the vocal cord mobility map.
Is it important only for your record purpose or anything else it is important? Just to know the vocal cord palsy. It's preoperatively done for what else? As a medico-legal issue, you should not get into trouble. So always you look for indirect laryngoscopy and record it in the case. Okay. It should be done.
Divya, when another question is asked for the indication for total thyroidectomy, anything else you can remember apart from malignancy, Graves' disease? I'll give you a clue. There's no disease at all, but still you do a thyroidectomy. Any prophylactic? Prophylactic?
In yes. case of, sir, if the patient is having RET mutation carrier in that case.
So you heard of men syndromes and all?
Yes.
Medullary carcinoma.
Yes.
How do you detect the syndrome in the family? Any test?
RET proto-oncogene genetic analysis. Like.
You don't have that facility. Any simple ones?
Serum calcitonin levels, sir. You can check.
If the levels are high in the siblings, prophylactic thyroidectomy is indicated. Yes.
I think now probably the total thyroidectomy has become a standard of care now, Jay. Even for the multinodular goiter.
Yes, sir.
Minimal surgery which is done is the hemithyroidectomy. There's nothing like now the subtotal thyroidectomy. You carry out the total thyroidectomy, and sometimes you may say that you will do a near total thyroidectomy if you are not sure that you are preserving the parathyroid or you're preserving the recurrent laryngeal nerve. From only that point of view, you can go for a near total, but otherwise, now the surgery is only the you have to carry out the hemithyroidectomy. If you are thinking that it is localized to like a case of polyponeoplasm, which is there, you can go for a hemithyroidectomy. That multinodular goiter is there. In that case, you go for the total thyroidectomy.
Total thyroid.
The patient here. So that has become almost now the standard of care.
See, surgeons' aim is to do a total thyroidectomy, but as Dr. Khanna sir just now told, certain areas where there is a probability of a doubt that you may injure the nerve, very, you know, especially that ligament of Berry area. Suppose your patient is a teacher or a singer or somebody like that. You can't take a chance and, you know, damage that nerve. So you may tend to leave behind. So it amounts to the near total. No? So our aim is to do a total. It may turn out to be a near total. That's what can happen.
Dr. Divya, how much tissue you leave usually in a near total thyroidectomy?
This is something which is
sir, around 4 to 8 grams of.
So how do you measure it during the surgery?
Sir, around like tip of thumb size of tip of thumb.
Tip of thumb is a big part of a thyroid gland.
What is the normal weight of the thyroid gland, Dr. Divya?
20 to 25 grams.
What do you do? How do you judge this? What amount of tissue you are going to leave to have a near total or subtotal? That is tissue which is present only in the tracheoesophageal groove.
Okay,
you leave that tissue and it nearly amounts to 4 to 7 grams. So you cannot weigh it during the surgery, right?
Yeah. Yes.
So leaving the tissues with the approximate that amount, that is equal to that, and it suffices for the thyroxine production. And it undergoes enlargement also. It increases in size and okay.
Divya.
Yes.
At what sites you can injure the recurrent angina? What are the different sites?
Sir, one is near the ligament of attachment of ligament of varices. It is recurrent laryngeal nerve is near to that point, and then another is in the tracheoesophageal groove, sir, and another is near the tubercle of Zucker candle, sir. And
what are the another nerve which you are concerned other than recurrent laryngeal nerve?
And the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve, sir.
So, what are the chances of injury? How will you prevent?
For prevention, we should ligate the superior thyroid artery near the superior pole, as near possible to the superior pole of the thyroid.
Right. What is the risk if you injure that now?
Sorry, sir.
What happens if you injure that now?
Sir, voice will be weak, sir. So, pitch of the voice cannot be high pitch cannot be regained, sir.
Right, that's true.
What are the precautions you will take regarding parathyroid? Not to injure the parathyroid. Mainly, the blood supply to the parathyroid also should be preserved. Not only injuring, So you should ligate the inferior thyroid artery after the branches. That is, you should take
it. Where is the location of parathyroid glands, Dr. Divya?
Sir, inferior parathyroid gland, sir, is the anterior to the recurrent laryngeal nerve, sir. And superior one is the posterior to the recurrent laryngeal nerve.
And they are just close to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. That is near the inferior thyroid artery. So they are not at the upper pole and lower pole of the thyroid gland.
And nowadays, the inferior thyroid artery is not ligated. What you do is the capsular dissection is done. So rather than, so you never ligate the main trunk of the inferior thyroid artery. Yeah, when you are doing the plain X-ray of the neck, how many views you want?
Sir, two views, sir. One is the anteroposterior and one is the lateral view. Sir.
Why two views?
Sir, anteroposterior view, sir, to see the deviation of the trachea, lateral deviation of the trachea, sir. Mm-hmm. And lateral, sir, to see the anteroposterior compression of the trachea.
So what is the significance of these two X-rays to the surgeon and to the anesthetist?
Sir, anteroposterior views, sir, thinking, sir, trachea is in central position and if it is deviated towards the one side, so during the thyroidectomy, we may injure the trachea, sir.
Okay, and from the anesthetist point of view?
Anesthetist point of view, sir, while intubation, sir, generally, anesthetist will go in the central position, so if it is deviated, so it may require some manipulation, sir, while intubation.
Okay. Then why the lateral view?
Lateral view, sir, if there is anteroposterior compression, sir, in the surgeon's point of view, in the post-operative period, there may be chances of tracheomalacia, sir. So we may need the post-operative intubation of the patient or the tracheostomy.
Right. And from the anesthetist point of view?
While, intubation, we may need the endotracheal tube less size because it is compressed. So, size of the endotracheal tube should be less.
Right. Sure.
Dr. Divya, after you're giving for histopathology, what and all you can do, find if you are suspecting a malignancy, can you differentiate papillary and follicular by histopathology and any staining methods?
Ma'am, in histology, papillary, we can see the histological features of the papillary carcinoma, ma'am. Like orphan any sign, and then intranuclear grooving, and sarcoma bodies will be visible. So it will suggest the papillary carcinoma. But in FNAC, ma'am, like follicular carcinoma and follicular adenoma cannot be differentiated. But with the biopsy, if there is capsular invasion or the angio invasion, vascular invasion, it more suggests towards the follicular carcinoma.
Any staining methods, you know, regarding papillary and follicular to differentiate? CK19, we call, no? You can find out by knowing the papillary carcinoma. Another is galactin-3. That can differentiate a benign, like follicular adenoma, from a follicular carcinoma.
The way FNAC has come out to be a follicular neoplasm, and your patient wants to know that, sir, do I have a carcinoma or do I have a benign one? Can you do something on that?
Sir, we can go for genetic testing or the KI67.
You can go for the KI67, yeah. 67. Yeah, so if that comes out to positive, then probably it's likely to be carcinoma. Yeah. Now, if at operation you have removed the tissue and you are not sure whether that is the parathyroid or not, what can you do?
Sir, we can send the sample to the frozen section, sir, and we can.
Frozen section is not available.
Sir, with the water dip test, we can know whether it is a parathyroid tissue or the like fat tissue. If it floats, sir, more likely it will be fatty tissue, and if it sinks, then sir, parathyroid tissue. Chances of parathyroid tissue will be removed.
And if you think it is a parathyroid tissue has been removed, what you will do with that?
While doing the thyroidectomy, sir, we can do the marsupialization of the parathyroid tissue into 1 millimeter fragments, and we can keep in the sternocleidomastoid, sir, within the pockets. By making the pocket, we can re-implant it in the sternocleidomastoid.
Now, this patient is a malignant patient, and you are not sure whether that is a parathyroid tissue or whether it's a lymph node.
Yes.
And if you have to re-implant that, where you will re-implant that?
Brachioradialis muscle, sorry, non-dominant hand of the brachioradialis.
Good.
Before implanting, what precaution you should take? There should not be any bleeding at the site of implantation, no? If there is bleeding, it will not take up. So, no hemorrhage. Okay.
Dr. Kanel, can we stop here or we should continue?
I think it's over.
It's already 10:20.
Yeah.
I will give the opportunity for Dr. Divya to ask questions. Do you have any doubts to be clarified,
Dr.? Only one small point, sir. This we say, you know, that famous Valentino appendix. So similarly, this Italian opera singer was Emilita Galli, Curci her name. So this she lost her voice. She was an opera singer after undergoing thyroidectomy and a damage to the external laryngeal nerve. So since that discussion had come, so I have put it in that nerve is actually goes in her name, is what people say. Just for information only. For PGs, yes.
Dr. Divya, any question from your side?
Sir, I want a clarification, sir, in case of prophylactic central neck dissection, sir, in case of thyroid malignancy, like what is the take?
Nowadays, in papillary carcinoma, it is not done, Dr. Divya. Central, you are talking about routine central neck dissection in papillary carcinoma. It was done, but now I think they have said they need not be done unless the nodes are enlarged. This is what I understand. You can ask the others.
Hemant sir, Shanti ma'am, what is your take on it, ma'am? Central compartment dissection.
Same thing is happening.
Same thing, sir.
It used if to be done, not, but
nowadays they don't.
If they are not palpable, you don't do the neck dissection in the thyroid carcinoma, like for other malignancies in the head and neck, where you do routinely prophylactic neck dissection. Here it is not done like that.
Thanks.
Yes, sir.